Good morning. It's good to be with you all on this Lord's Day. And I want to encourage you all who are in Christ, who are conquerors and more than conquerors. Let us live victoriously in these days, and let not our hearts be troubled, because our Lord is with us and he has prepared a place for us. And soon, our trials and tribulations will be forgotten, and we will be with him in glory forever and ever. But for now, he's with us, and we live victoriously. We keep our eyes fixed upon him, who is the author and finisher of our faith. So let's pray together, and let's worship today. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your mercy, your grace, and most of all, Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for Jesus, that he is in our life, that we walk with him, Lord God, and that, Lord God, we have the great promise that he will never leave us or forsake us. And we glory in him this morning. We glory, Lord God, in your great blessings that you've poured out upon us through Yeshua, our HaMashiach, our Messiah, our Savior. And we glorify you, Lord God, this day in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on.
So I hope you're home with the Lord, resting in his joy and his love and living in his light. God is blessing Living Word Community Church. I just want to encourage you all, if you have not been partaking and getting involved in just prayer and Bible studies, they're going on all week long. If you do not know about the Bible studies going on all week long, you can go to our website at livingwordalive.com, and there's information there. But there are women's Bible studies going on. There's men's Bible studies. There's programs for the kids going on during the week, and prayer meetings. And I just want to encourage you, you know, get involved. And, you know, a lot of people just sitting and watching hours and hours of wasteful television instead of engaging in prayer, because God is answering our prayers in such a powerful way. And maybe in all the years of Living Word, I don't think I've ever seen God answering prayers like he's answering right now. And I know the people of God are calling upon his name and really believing and trusting in faith, praying that prayer of faith, and God is hearing us. Of all the people in our church, and there's about 13 who were diagnosed with the virus, all are well, healing. We do pray that there are some that are still going through the healing process, Gita, Maria, but God is healing people. So, you know, just be engaged, continue to pray. He's protecting our workers in the front lines, the nurses and the doctors and the ambulance workers and the policemen, all the people who are out there. So we're just grateful. We're grateful for what God is doing. He's working in a really very powerful way. And I hope you're seeing that. And that should be inspiring you to get down on your knees and pray with us and be in one accord. For where two or more gathered, he is there in a very special and unique way. And though we may not be holding hands and be shoulder to shoulder, we are praying together, and God honors that. I just want to encourage you on Wednesday night, I'm going to be doing actually a three-week series called The Power of the Living Word. And that is on Zoom, the same station you're on right now. That'll be at 7 p.m. The Power of the Word. I just see, again, how the Word of God is just so empowering. And in a time where I think people are experiencing weakness, many people getting caught up in fear, worry, anxiety, the Word of God, just being in the Word and having God's Word just infuse you with that power and with that strength. So that will be on a Wednesday at 7 p.m. And then what I would like you to do, we will share communion at the end of the message, and then we will go into prayer. So have a piece of bread, have the grape juice. If you don't have grape juice, whatever juice will do fine. God will honor you with that. And we'll share the Lord's Supper on Wednesday night, and then we will go right into prayer. So I want to thank you all for your faithfulness in just giving your tithes and offerings to Living Word Community Church. Again, this has greatly encouraged me as the pastor and the leadership in the church. God has been blessing us, and really in an amazing way. And we're just so thankful to you all for your faithfulness, God. Again, I can stand here as your pastor and speak to you, as what God has put upon my heart. And he just says, thank you for giving to the Lord. And, we're going through this month, and, we're covering our budget. And it looks like as we go towards the end of this month, we'll be able to cover our missionary budget. And that's a blessing. So I just want to say thank you. And I know you don't have the opportunity to put your check into the basket right now, but I just would just say, hey, Lord, thank you so much for my brothers and sisters, and for the opportunity, Lord God, that you've given to us to really step over and above in our faithfulness. Bless them all, Lord God. You promise that, Lord God, to the faithful you show yourself faithful. And Lord God, I just pray that your faithfulness would just be poured out upon every soul, Lord God, that is, Lord God, just, Lord, they're just operating and serving you in that faithfulness. And bless them, and Lord God, just pour out, Lord God, your blessings upon them, their families, their children, them at work. And in Jesus' name we pray this, amen.
Hey, this is Lenny Savino. I just wanted to share a song the Lord gave me from Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3 and 4, and John chapter 16, verse 33. It's called Perfect Peace. Perfect peace. What does that mean? Perfect peace. That's what I need. Perfect peace. What does that mean? Perfect peace. That's what I see. Me, he opened up my eyes to see what he sees. And though the death and darkness is creeping around me, he whose mind has stayed on him, he keeps in perfect peace. Peace beyond all understanding. Anything I see, sweet peace, it overwhelms me to my heart from the heart of the Prince of Peace. Perfect peace, oh now I see, perfect peace, it's Christ living in me. That's what he brings, perfect peace. It's Christ living in me, that we may know you, Jesus. Brings us life eternally, the one and only true God. You give us perfect peace. The burdens of our backs, Lord, you bore in yours, we see. As you overcame the world, perfect peace. Peace beyond all understanding. Peace beyond anything I see. Sweet peace. It overwhelms me to my heart from the heart. Heart from the heart of the Prince of Peace. Perfect peace. Oh, now I see. Perfect peace. It's Christ living in me. Perfect peace. That's what he brings.
Lenny, thank you. God bless you. Great blessing. Hey, do you see those lines? Well, you know what? The one big arrow is going down. The other ones are going this way. It's like the world we live in. Everybody's, you know, just all over the place in confusion. And by the way, I don't know what those lines are, but they just appeared on my screen. And I'm just going to go through my message and not even try to remove them, because I will probably end up removing the entire message. So be patient with me with that. And if you know what it is, you can notify us at the end of the service, and we'll figure it out. But I have a message for you. It is, be in my light, from Philippians chapter 4. Be in my light. And I'm going to be reading to you here, Philippians chapter 4, verse 4 through 7. The word of the Lord, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And our Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord God, this day, there is great blessing in your light. Your light is life. And Lord God, when we are in your light, when we are in your truth, Father God, we are in a place of blessing, a place of peace, a place of joy, Lord, a place of strength. And Lord God, again, in these days, so many, Lord God, that I talk to, they need to be in your light and just be enjoying, Lord God, all the blessings that come. So, Father, just be with us today. Minister to our hearts. We sit at your feet. We open up, Lord God, our minds. We just devote ourselves and focus in on you, Jesus. And I pray, may, Lord God, may all those who are watching this, Lord, in this hour, may they be looking into your face, hearing your voice. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So in Psalm 119, verse 18, and I was meditating on Psalm 119, which I usually do on Sunday mornings. I read Psalms every day, but on Sunday mornings, I go through Psalm 119. And the word just jumped out, you know, to me, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. And I pray that today, that your eyes would be open to see the wonderful things that God has given to us through Philippians chapter 3. Philippians is an incredible book. It's the book of joy. And written by the Apostle Paul while he was in prison. He wasn't sitting on a beach drinking a pina colada down in Jamaica. He was in jail. And it is in jail where he wrote this incredible epistle that, again, is filled with the joy and the peace of the Lord. So in the third chapter, and it is absolutely one of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible, one of the most practical chapters in the Bible of really understanding how God would have us to live and how he would have us to really enter in into the joy and the peace that he has for us. So just looking at our world right now, and I do see this, and I see this with some people in the church, believe it or not, people turning towards alcohol in these times. And the Associated Press recorded that U.S. online alcohol sales are up 243% through the coronavirus pandemic, but alcohol sales are up all around. People, you know, turning to alcohol instead of turning to Jesus. They're medicating themselves from their anxieties and their fears and their worries. Average TV binge watching 8 hours a day. That's a lot of TV. Again, people medicating themselves on Amazon Prime movies or Netflix. People turning to pornography and pornography. The visiting of internet sites and the money being spent on pornography is exploding right now. And again, people turning towards darkness and turning towards those things to medicate themselves instead of turning to Jesus. Online gambling up 100% since the coronavirus. And people, you know, binging on food. 40% of people are binging on junk food. And I think in a time where we should be more working on ourselves and not only on our spirits, but our minds, our souls, and our bodies, people, again, medicating themselves with food. But again, all these things are just, they're just indicators of people who are turning not towards Jesus, but turning towards the world instead of turning to his light and entering into his light. Because in his light, again, there is tremendous blessing. So I want to focus on that. Be in my light. And what Philippians 3 tells us about what we will receive as we enter into his light and the blessings that will come to us through it. So the first thing, be in joy. And in verse 4, Philippians 4, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice two times. Rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. And this is an invitation for us to enter into the very joy, the supernatural joy of the Lord. Now, to understand again, Paul was in prison when he wrote this. he's not, again, he's not in a, you know, a place of, you know, where most of us would equate joy with. He's not at the amusement park. He's not at the ball game. He's not at the party. He's not at the barbecue. He's in jail with a Roman soldier looking over his shoulder. And it's there that he wrote the epistle to the Philippians. So Paul here is talking about really a joy that transcends circumstances. He is not talking about happiness. Happiness depends upon happenings. Happiness is something that people pursue. Joy is something that we enter into and live in. You understand the difference between the two. Happiness is a feeling based upon circumstances. Something good happens and then you're happy. Again, it's dependent upon happenings. Joy is an attitude that defies circumstances. It really transcends circumstances. It's above, again, the circumstances of life. Here's a great illustration that describes the difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is external. It's dependent upon externals. And joy is internal. It's something that occurs within our soul, our psyche, our heart. Happiness is dependent upon circumstances, and joy is independent of circumstances. Happiness is an emotional response. Joy is an act of the will. It's a choice that we make to enter into joy. Happiness is having what we want, and joy is wanting what you have. Happiness is external euphoria. Joy is inner contentment. Happiness is an effect, and joy is a cause. Happiness is a result, and joy is a foundation. Happiness is inconsistent. It comes and it goes. It's like the weather. And joy is consistent. And happiness is temporary, and joy is eternal. But to understand that, again, happiness is something that depends upon happenings. And joy is something, again, that transcends happenings. It is a very, you know, foundation. And it is really a core. It is the core that we essentially as Christians should be living in. So the person that is living and basically in happiness, they're a thermometer. They're on the roller coaster. They're up and they're down, right? Something good happens, they're happy. Something bad happens, they're sad. And I think a lot of people are walking around as thermometers today. Even people look at when I watch a little bit of the news and I watch, you know, certain things that are going on. I see people, again, the financial people, when the market's up, they're happy. When the market's down, they're sad. People who are, you know, reporting the media. In fact, I have one reporter, popular reporter on that does the news, and he was saying it's springtime and I'm not experiencing the spring. Again, that's a person who is a thermometer. But a thermostat controls the temperature. And the person who is a thermostat, that is the person who is really living in joy, who is rejoicing in the Lord. And they have that joy consistently day in and day out. The person, again, who is living in joy is the person who is focused on Jesus. See, everything is in flux. Everything is changing. We're experiencing more change in our lifetimes than ever before. I'm experiencing more change in my lifetime than in the previous 60 years that I've lived here on this earth. This is a time of flux. This is a time of change. You hear the word all the time. I'm sick of hearing it. In fact, I'm going to say it, but I don't even want to hear it again. Unprecedented change, right? This is unprecedented times. It's unprecedented. I'm sorry I said it three times. I know most of you are sick of hearing that, but it is a time of tremendous change. But the word of God tells us in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus the Messiah, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus is the same. He doesn't change. He is the same merciful Lord, graceful Lord. He is the same holy Lord, loving Lord continuously. He doesn't change. He's not in flux. He's not on a roller coaster ride. He's not a thermometer. He is the greatest thermostat that is. And he is always consistent. He is always true. He is always faithful. He is always loving. He is always forgiving. He is always compassionate. He is always kind. He is always generous. He's always giving. He's always the same. And when we build our life on him, see, that's how we enter into his joy. And that's where we could say, rejoice in the Lord always. And whether you are in the storm or you're on a sunny day, okay, we can rejoice in the Lord always. Whether you have victory or defeat, you can rejoice in the Lord always. Whether you are on the mountaintop or going through the valley of the shadow of death, you can rejoice with the Lord always, because he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it is because of him being with us, this immutable, unchangeable Lord, our Lord Jesus, as we walk with him, as we talk with him, as we fellowship with him, as we live in his presence, we can say, as Paul has said, rejoice in the Lord always. And that is a wonderful blessing that the Lord has poured upon us. I pray that the Lord would just illuminate your soul to that great truth. We as Christians need to be living in that joy and rejoicing in his love, rejoicing in him, rejoicing in his presence always. All right, number two, be in my presence. So in verse 5, let your gentleness be known to all men. He says, the Lord is at hand. What is that? The Lord is with us. He is here with me right now. He is here with you. He is there with you right now. We are living in his presence. In Exodus chapter 33, verse 14 through 16, Moses, and you can see Moses, this great man of God, how he valued, he treasured in the very presence of God. And it tells us that he said to God, God says to him first, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. When we are in the presence of God, we will find rest. And then he said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not bring us up from here. For how then will it be known that your people and I have found grace in your sight, except you go with us? So we shall be separate, your people and I, from all people who are upon the face of the earth. Understand what Moses is saying there. It is the presence of God in our lives that makes us unique. It is the presence of God in our lives that really gives us rest. It is the presence of God that really makes us distinct from the other people of this world. The other people of this world do not have the presence of God. Look around and you can see your secular neighbors, your secular relatives. You can see them all. And they are not living in the presence of God. They do not have that blessing of rest and of peace that comes to them through the presence. So it's essentially when we are in the presence of God, we are the children of God. And I believe when we are aware of the presence of God comes great rest and comes great blessing. In Ephesians chapter 3:12, it gives to us really the again opportunity and the privilege that we have as believers to enter into the presence of God. So it says, now we can come fearlessly, right, without fear, boldly, right into the presence of God, into God's presence, assured that his glad welcome when we come with Christ and trust in him. We have this privilege because we have been washed by the blood of the Lamb. We are God's children. We are God's redeemed. We can cry out to our God and we can call him Abba, Father. We have this great honor of being able to enter into his presence. And again, notice assured of his glad welcome and his welcome, his arms are open. It's like when my grandkids, when I have an opportunity to see them, and those of you see little John Carlo around the church, it is my joy. The first thing I do when I see him is open my arms and welcome him, just to come and give him a hug and a kiss. That's our Heavenly Father. Our Heavenly Father rejoices in us coming to him, and we have the privilege to be able to come to him fearlessly, right into his presence. And again, to know with an assurance that he welcomes us, and we should be drawing into his presence with again that assurance. We should be drawing near to him and dwelling in his presence and living in his presence, because it's there in his presence where again we share his light. It is a great joy to be in his presence. And again, I pray in the light of the Lord this morning that you would realize that you can be living and dwelling in the presence of God all day long. You can be enjoying his presence, his rest, his strength, and his blessing as you dwell there. Okay, number three, be in peace. And in verses 6 and 7, okay, we have, be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about nothing. But in everything, in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Now, you look at that passage, be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about nothing. Don't be fearful about nothing. You know, again, that's easier said than done. But again, you have an, and I don't like to take the word of God and formalize it or turn it into a formula. But if you look at what is said here, be anxious about nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, prayer, intense prayer, but praying with thanksgiving. And that's the key. That's the bridge. It's prayer with thanksgiving that brings peace, because I believe that prayer alone, just asking God or seeking God for things without thanksgiving, does not bring peace. But it's when we are praying with thanksgiving that there is peace. So again, to make it again, to look like a formula, prayer plus thanksgiving equals the peace of God. When we are praying, I mean, just giving thanks. In fact, I was praying in a prayer group at the church, this was last year, and basically all I was praying was just prayers of thanksgiving, and we had much to be thankful for. God was working amongst us, people had been healed, people had been saved, we're seeing God providing for the body of Christ. And I just was praying, a prayer of thanksgiving. Then when I stopped praying, some other people began to pray, and they began to intercede and lift up supplication, asking God for things. And when I was done, there was a woman there, she was visiting the church, and she said to me, "Pastor, is that how you pray all the time?" And I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "All you did was give thanks." Well, thanksgiving is really a major part of my prayer life. And I think people who don't take time to give thanks to God, they don't realize all the blessings that God is pouring out into their life. And they also, when they are not thanking God for the answered prayers, I think this was something that happened to me years ago. When I began to write out a prayer of thanks every morning, I began to see that God was answering 98% of my prayers daily, that he was answering prayers continuously, and prayers, again, of provision, prayers of deliverance, prayers multiple healings, prayers of salvation for people, that God was answering my prayers continuously. And because I wasn't taking time to acknowledge that and to be reminded of all the things that he was doing, I wasn't giving thanks, and I wasn't aware of the power of prayer. It was when I began to pray with thanksgiving that I really began to grasp onto the power of prayer. So prayer plus thanksgiving, that brings us the peace of God. And again, the peace of God. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. As the world gives, do I give to you." He says, "Not as the world gives, do I give to you." And then he says, "Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." But he is saying here, essentially, it is the peace of God. Is that, again, that supernatural peace, the same, you know, peace that transcends all understanding. We don't fully grasp it, but it comes pouring into our hearts, and it's the peace that we can have in the midst of the storms, in midst of trials, in midst of tribulation. But it's that supernatural peace that comes to us when we are praying to the Lord, right, in the name of Jesus, praying according to his will, praying by faith, with thanksgiving, that suddenly that peace just comes and infuses our souls. Jesus said, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation." He never pulled punches. Listen, I'll say this to you. When you listen to somebody, and it could be anybody, this could be somebody preaching the word of God, this could be somebody who's trying to sell you something, somebody who's trying to get you to invest in something. When people are just totally, you know, they're never giving you bad news. I'll tell you, be warned about people like that. They're usually con artists. A lot of preachers, it's always good news, and they're con men. Jesus never conned. Again, he never pulled punches. He spoke the truth, and he spoke the truth purely because he was the truth, the very fountainhead of all truth. But he said this, in the world, you will have tribulation. We're going to have tribulation in this world. In the next world, in the next life, we won't have tribulation. But in this world, you will have tribulation. But he says that in me, you may have peace. And again, I believe that when we are in prayer and we are giving thanks to him, of which all blessings have come from, we enter into that shalom, that great shalom, that peace, that well-being of God. And even in the midst of the storm, we can be in a place of his peace. So again, I encourage you, you know, enter into the light of this wonderful word in Philippians, that we can come in and just bathe ourselves in the light of his presence, and to pray to him and to be giving thanksgiving to him, and to let that peace of God that transcends all understanding fill our hearts. Okay, number four, be thinking. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, he says, meditate on these things. He's saying, think about these things. Think about the things that are true, that are noble, that are just, that are pure, that are lovely, that are of a good report, that are virtuous, that are praiseworthy. Fill your minds, meditate. You know, Jewish or the Hebraic meditation is to think upon the word of God. You know, Eastern meditation is to empty your mind. To meditate biblically is to fill your mind with the revelations of God. And that's what this passage is saying. Fill your mind, meditate upon the very revelations of God instead of filling your mind with the negative garbage of the world. And again, we get inundated with the negative garbage of the world like never before. Being that, you know, this mass, you know, media that is, you know, coming at us, but meditate upon the word of God. The scripture here, you know, filter your thoughts through God's word. You know, think about this. Is what I am thinking about true? Am I focused on the truth? Because there's a ton of deception out there. And it's coming to us again through the television. It's coming through us through our handheld device. It's coming through us through the internet. Is what I'm thinking about true? Is it noble? Nobility, you know, to be noble, to be a person of tremendous, uncompromising character. Are the things that you're allowing into your heart and your soul, are they noble? Are they right? Or are they wrong? Are they pure or impure? Are they lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy? The word of God is telling us, think, meditate upon these things. You know, we are what we eat, and we are what we think, and we are what we allow to come into our brain that we focus upon. It's a great saying, sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. And think about it, the things that we think about, the things that we most consistently allow into our brains are going to transform us and make us into what they are. In Psalm 1, again, one of my favorite psalms, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Think about that. Are you sitting in the seat of the scornful? Are you sitting there looking at things that God haters are propagating and basically programming you with? And think about television, because they're television programs, they're programming, and they're seeking to program us all the time. Same thing again through different things on the internet, on YouTube, on Netflix, on Amazon. Are we sitting in the seat of the scornful? People who hate God. Look, the programs that they produce are, do you ever hear Jesus' name mentioned except mentioned in vain? Or sitting in the council of the ungodly, or standing with the path of sinners, you know, are you putting yourself in the place where you're allowing the devil and the world to program you? But notice again, the man of God, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight is in the word of God. And in his law, he meditates day and night. He's thinking about it, right? Even if he doesn't have the Bible in front of him, it's there. It's in his mind. It's sinking down into his heart. It's working itself out into his hands, into his eyes, into his ears. It says, he shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water. Let me say this, rivers of living water that bring forth its fruit in season. He's fruitful. He's bearing the fruit of the Spirit, whose leaf shall not wither. He's not withering away. You see people's souls withering away. People who have been focused, again, being fed the deception and the lies of the world continuously, their souls, you see this, so their souls are withering away. And whatever he does shall prosper. He's a man who is successful. She's a woman who is successful because, again, their mind is focused on the living word of God. That's what they're meditating on. So again, I want to just encourage you with this, to live in the light of God's word, meditating, thinking upon it, memorizing it, studying it, reading it, allowing it to just flow into your mind and into your heart and transform you. Number five, be practicing. I have be a practicing, but be practicing. Philippians 4:9. These things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me. Paul saying here, I am an example to you. He said, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. So be a practitioner of the word of God. Be putting it essentially into practice, right? Jesus, in his conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount, he ends with the wise and foolish builders. You know, ask yourself that, which one are you? He says this in chapter 7 of Matthew, verse 24 through 27. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, there's the key thing, to hear and to do. He says, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on the house. And it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended and the floods came and the wind blew and beat on that house and it fell and great was its fall. So which one are you? Are you a person who hears the word and does it, or somebody who just hears the word and does not do it? Being a practitioner. And I see a lot of people, right, again, going through this trial. This is a time of the flood. The flood has come. And as the flood has come, I see some people whose house is being washed away. And then I see people whose house is built firmly upon the rock and it's standing firm. Hey, folks, let me just say this to you. You know, this trial that we're going through, this flood that we're going through, right? Paul was in prison. I read the memoirs of Anne Frank, who hid in an attic for 2 years. Read the stories of Corrie ten Boom. Read the stories of Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who was put in the gulag for his belief in Jesus Christ under the communist Russians. But you look at these people and what they went through, but they built their house upon the rock and they stood firm. You know, things might be, you know, have changed. They might be difficult, but let me tell you something, they could be far worse. And if you have built your house on the rock, I think you're in a time where you're in a place of peace. You're in a place of joy. If you have not built your house upon the rock, you're getting washed away. And I'll tell you, that is not to make you feel guilty or bad. But hey, today, make your decision to build your house upon the rock, to get founded, to be not only a hearer of God's word, but a doer of it. James chapter 1, 22 through 25, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. He goes and he looks at himself in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. He forgets what he looks like. Really, in a sense, person looks at themselves in the mirror, they forget who they are. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it. And that's the key thing. Hearing the word and doing it, they continue in it. And is not forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. And again, that is the key, to be a hearer and a doer of the word, a practitioner of the word, to be one who continues in it. When you're hearing a sermon today, are you going to do it, or is it going to go one ear and out the other? When you're reading the word each day, are you looking to apply it to your life? taking that word with you and not leaving it there, right? Leaving it there in the Bible and walking away from it and forgetting it, but taking it with you and practicing it. And listen, when you put things into practice, understand, like all things, you need to learn to crawl before you can walk. You need to learn to walk before you can run, and you need to really to run before you can sprint. But just to understand this, you're not going to practice it perfectly. You're going to crawl it first. But the Lord rejoices in his baby Christians who crawl and then one day stand up and begin to walk. And then as they begin to walk, one day begin to run. And then they begin to sprint. But being a hearer of the word and not merely just somebody, right? They just hear and then they don't do, but being a doer as well. Hear and do the word. Be consistent. Be a doer of the word of God. All right, number six, be content. Boy, is this relevant to the day that we're in right now. The word of God says, but I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at last you care for me as has flourished again. Though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am in to be content. I want you to notice just that word content for a moment. The word is autarxes, and it's a word that speaks of peaceful satisfaction through the Lord. Peaceful satisfaction through the Lord. Essentially, the word autarxes, it was a Stoic word that was used for people who are self-sufficient. Paul takes it here, and he uses it for a person who is God-sufficient, a person who is in relationship with the Lord, and the Lord is satisfying their needs. So he says in verse 12, I know what it is to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And then he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There's the autarxes. It is the Lord who has sufficiently given us everything we need to be in a place of contentment. The concept here, again, contentment is not dependent on circumstances. Paul is writing about being content when he is in prison. He is likely hungry. He may be thirsty. Okay, he doesn't have the freedom. He doesn't have the liberty. So you see, it's not dependent upon circumstances. Contentment is essentially something. You can be totally content sitting on the ground, and you could be totally discontented sitting upon a throne. And all you need to do is look at people in the world to see that. You see people who are rich and who are absolutely miserable, and you see people who are poor who are absolutely joyful. You can see people who are in leadership who are the most miserable people in the world. All you need to do is look at Washington. Look at the Senate and the Congress. And then you can see people who are absolutely euphoric, who have no power at all. So whether you're sitting on the ground with little or sitting on the throne, contentment has nothing to do with your situation. It's a state of the heart. Somebody wrote this: contentment comes from being fully convinced that God is God, that you belong to him, that he loves you madly, and that he is always with you. C.S. Lewis writes about that during World War II, when the Nazis were blitzkrieging London and were literally leveling the city, the people would hide in the subways below. And as they were hiding in the subways, he said that most people were filled with fear, filled with anxiety. Many people were miserable, distraught. And he said that the only people he saw who were filled with joy were people who were in love, whether old or young, people who were with their spouse, they were with their loved one, and they were filled with joy. And he uses that as an illustration that we could be going through trying times, we could be going through tribulation, we could be going through the storms, but when we are with the one we love, there is contentment and there is joy. So in the light of the Lord's word here, I pray that you would enter into that contentment that comes from being in the presence and living in the one who will provide all of our needs, who is Jesus Christ. And the last point I want to make, be faithful. So in verse 14 through 20, you have the conclusion of the chapter. It says, "Nevertheless, you have done well that you shared in my distress." So he's saying here that the Philippians gave to Paul in his time of distress. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. Philippians were not only a joyful church, a peaceful church, they were a giving church. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Paul is talking about the blessing of the Lord that has come to them. He says, "Indeed, I have all and abound. I am fully, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice." There's a good picture of our giving. It is a sweet-smelling aroma to the Lord. When we are giving our offerings, it is something, again, we are giving to God, well-pleasing to God. And he says this, "And may my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen." And I want you to see what is being said here. Paul is saying to the Philippians, because of your faithfulness in your giving, God is providing and he will give to you. Now I want to show you something here, and this is important. Again, Psalm 18:25 makes this clear. "To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless." And that is, I believe, true. Now, you may be sitting there and going, but God was faithful to me before I was faithful to him. And I think we'd all agree with that. God first loved me before I loved him. So the picture there, God has always been the initiator of the relationship. He was the initiator. He was the one who poured out his mercy, his forgiveness, his grace, his love upon us. It all began with God. Our part is to trust and respond to his efforts. So again, he was faithful to us first, and now we are to be faithful to him. We love him because he first loved us. He poured out his love upon us in Jesus Christ, and now our natural response should be that we are loving him. So that is the picture here. Again, it begins with God, but we are to respond in faithfulness. And if we do not respond in faithfulness, folks, I don't believe God has an obligation to be faithful to us. "To the faithful, you show yourself faithful." Again, I understand it begins with him, but we need to respond in faithfulness to him. And again, this is just merely talking in our stewardship and in our tithing and in our giving. Everything. He's given us mercy. We should show him mercy. Think of the story, the parable of the unforgiving servant. And here I think you see this principle being made very clear. So you have this man, and he owes the master, he owes the leader, he owes him $1 million. And he goes to him and he begs for him to forgive him, for him to help him. And the master is very gracious, and he forgives him the entire debt of $1 million. Now, he could have put him in jail, he could have made him a slave, but he forgives him. He absolves him of the entire debt canceled. And so the man leaves, and he finds a guy who owes him $500. And he says to him, "I want my $500. Guy doesn't have the $500 to give him. He goes and he begins to choke the guy. And then he takes the guy and he throws him in jail. And he says, "Until you pay me back my entire debt, you're not getting out." So he was shown incredible mercy, but he did not show mercy. And so what happens? Well, the master, he says to him, "Take that scoundrel and throw him in jail until he has paid me back his full debt." Now understand the story and the picture here. The mercy begins, and Jesus is relating this to God the Father, to him. The mercy begins and comes to us through God. And now the expectation is that we will show mercy. If we refuse to show mercy, we're going to have a major issue with God. And I believe the same thing applies to all other areas of our life with whatever God has given us. If he has blessed us, he has blessed us financially. He expects us to give back to him. If we refuse to give back to him, there should be no belief that we are going to experience continued faithfulness from God. So to the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. And here again, in this final exhortation that the Lord gives us, live in the light of his faithfulness. Be inspired, be moved by his faithfulness. Let the faithfulness and the love of God compel you to be faithful to him in all things. And then you can expect that faithfulness of God to continue to flow into your life. So our final application of living in the light, be in joy. Be in joy. Rejoice in the Lord. Make the Lord your joy. Live like a thermostat, not like a thermometer. Be in his presence, because his presence is with you. And enjoy his presence. Enjoy the light of his presence, the renewing grace of his presence. Be in peace. Pray, but pray with thanksgiving. And expect that supernatural peace, that shalom of God that transcends all understanding, to come and guard your heart and fill your heart. Be thinking upon his word. Be thinking upon that which is good and is virtuous and is excellent and is praiseworthy. Be meditating on his word. Be practicing. Don't just merely be a hearer, but be a doer. You know, hearing this word today is useless to you unless you put it into practice. It is totally useless. You'll walk away and you'll forget it. You'll forget it in an hour. But take it and put it into practice and do it. And you will reap massive benefits in your soul, in your life. Be content. Autarkes, self-reliant, no. God-reliant, yes. Rely upon the Lord, because he will provide for you everything that you need. And know that you can do all things through the God who strengthens you. And finally, be faithful. Be faithful in what God has given you. Because when we are faithful to what the Lord has blessed us with, he will continue to be faithful to us. Don't be like that fool who the master was so faithful to and forgave him his debt. And then he went away and he showed no mercy to that man who owed him. But be faithful. Be faithful in your impartation of mercy. Be faithful in your giving. And you can live with the expectation that God will be faithful to you. So live in his light. Be in his light and be in Jesus. And I will just say this to you. If Jesus is not living in your heart, if he is not your personal Lord and Savior, you have the opportunity today, right now where you're sitting, just bow your head and ask Jesus to come into your heart. Pray to him right now and just say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I have sinned against you, but I believe that you died for me on the cross to take away my sins, and you were raised from the dead to impart to me your life. And right now, Jesus, I take you into my heart and into my life to be my personal Lord and Savior. And I'll just say this to you. If you prayed that prayer sincerely this morning, you prayed that prayer sincerely from your heart, well, you have just received the gift of eternal life. And all the blessings that we were focusing on this morning, they are there for you to enter into and to enjoy. Enter into his light, live in his light, and be blessed. I want to share with you one more song before we close. And this is my favorite Christian song ever. And I think many of you are going to hear this for the first time this morning. It's called Pia Gesù. And I just want you to sit there. It's in Latin, sung in Latin, but the words are translated into English, and they're just very beautiful words, very simple song. When I hear it truly, I think it may be the closest song I've ever heard to the way we will hear the angels sing. But sit back and enjoy this song, and then we'll close in prayer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The Lord God grant you all his peace and his blessing in the Lord Jesus. Father God, thank you, Lord God, for this day. And I pray, Lord God, that you would just be with us all. And that, Lord God, we would just rest in your loving hands and in your peace and in your grace for everyone, Lord God. Everyone at Living Word Community Church, our friends and our guests, Lord God, who are watching with us this morning and all who will watch this video, Lord God, in upcoming days, may the rest of Jesus just, Lord God, fill their souls, their minds, and their hearts. That supernatural rest. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, God bless you all. Be well. I'll be back on with you on Wednesday. And again, plug into some of the Bible studies that are going on. And the Lord bless you all and be with you all. Amen.